Ladies and gentlemen, my greetings to all of you. I am very happy that through the Hindu platform, the celebrated newspaper of India, I am getting the privilege to talk to IAS aspirants of the country. We are living in a world where the physical world is being dominated by the digital world. And when the request came to me that I can talk to young friends having the ambition to become civil servants, they gave me a topic to talk about ethical values of civil services or any topic of my choice. I have not to elaborate on ethical values. That is what a civil servant must have always if he has to excel as a civil servant. And by ethical values, in my view, it simply means remain true to your professional ethics. Imbibe the extraordinary values of integrity. Don't fall prey to corruption. And above all, have a heart for the poor and underprivileged whom you are going to serve. If you keep these values in mind, surely you will see a different kind of professional fulfillment. And remember one thing very clearly. India is a democracy, an open society. There's a lot of PILs, RTI, and other forums of accountability. Therefore, if as a civil servant, you adopt means which are not fair, then at some point in time, you will surely have to suffer. The Narendra Modi government, now a 360 degree review is done of officers for all in-service promotions. And I can put it very straight, what was your reputation as a collector? A feedback is taken from your peers. Similarly at other levels. And then when you go higher, a comprehensive assessment is made as to whether your professionalism, your delivery, your performance, and most important, your integrity entitles you for promotion or not. This, I am very clear, is a very novel method where in-service promotion does not come as an entitlement by way of seniority, but must be merit-based as gathered from your performance over the years. But after flagging these general issues of ethical values and practices of civil service, I would like to talk today on a subject of my great choice, Digital India. Because remember, my young friends, wish you good luck to succeed. When you will occupy your chair as a civil servant, be it IAS or any other civil service, the digital world is going to become the most important world with which you will have to grapple administration. And I am very proud to say my Prime Minister launched a very extraordinary program, Digital India. And this, the characteristic of this program he outlined in the campaign itself before the 2014 election, where he said, if I get the mandate of the people, I'll try my best to create an India where IT plus IT is equal to IT. What does it mean? IT, information technology, plus IT, India's talent, is equal to IT, India tomorrow. And thereafter, as the communication, IT and law minister, he gave this extraordinary responsibility on my shoulders. What is Digital India? Digital India simply means a program to empower ordinary Indians with the power of technology. Bridge the digital divide. And most important, bring in digital inclusion. And this must be achieved through technology, which is homegrown, developmental, and also inclusive, and low cost. Now kindly see how we have traveled in the last few years. Remember one particular statistics about India. Population 130 crore plus, mobile phone 120 crores, a smartphone close to 70 crores, Aadhaar card 126 crores, internet penetration nearly 700 million, close to 70 crores. And if we take mobile internet broadband, mobile internet, then 95% of India stands covered. In this light, how we have leveraged this technology to change India? I will come to discuss how we face the challenge of COVID using digital technology separately. But kindly see, and this you will grapple with when you will become a collector or a district magistrate or other development officer. This delivery of welfare measures was the biggest nagging problem of India's governance. A former Prime Minister of India has said, I send rupees 100 from Delhi and only rupees 15 reaches the village. What we did under the inspiring leadership of the Prime Minister, Narendra Modi ji, we opened close to 42 crore bank account of the poor, which we call Jan Dhan. Now every poor has access to bank account. Link that with Aadhaar, the digital identity to supplement the physical identity through biometrics, iris and fingerprint. And link this with mobile. And then we started a new institution, DBT, Direct Benefit Transfer. The gas subsidy, the Manrega payment, the ration subsidy, and a whole range of other welfare measures. Today, nearly 400 plus central government and state government's schemes ride on DBT. And the last close to 5.5 years, we have disbursed 13 lakh crore, 175 billion, directly to the bank account of the poor. And how much we have saved? 1.78 lakh crore, $24 billion. Why? Fictitious claimants, gas or Manrega payments. Do you know, in many states, Manrega workers only remain on the register of Mukhiya or village panchayat office bearers. Here, the amount goes to the bank account of the Manrega workers directly. Tea garden workers, women workers, their entitlement goes to the bank account. This kind of a tectonic improvement in delivery of government schemes through technology is a milestone of governance, which is going to be replicated all over the country and now globally also. Take the case of this pandemic. As I say, in lighter vein, in the COVID, there was no rail movement, no plane movement, and no highway movement. But my department, be it communication, be it IT, be it postal department, became the fulcrum of country's connectivity. The mobile phone, the landline, the internet, the IT operations. The first thing which arose as a challenge was, how would India's IT sector work? Because the professionals could not go to office. Then they came with the idea of work from home. I liberalized the entire regulatory mechanism. And 85% of Indians worked from home, sitting on the laptop or on the desktop or mobile. And then our Prime Minister said, make it work from anywhere. This became a new model for the global developing world to follow. Take the case of education. Can you believe that India's school education was substantially maintained because children were getting digital education? And even poor children were getting their education on mobile. Since I handle law portfolio also, you'll be happy to know that 60 lakh plus cases were heard by the Supreme Court, High Court and District Courts digitally. It's still continuing. Therefore, and not only this, this whole delivery of entitlement to the poor people, I just wanted to tell you that 8,000 crores have been delivered by my postal department in the far-flung areas of the country where my postman went with an app to make digital payment where there is no ATM or bank branch. Take the case of DBT, other use for farmers. These days farmers issue are very much in news. We are sending every year 6,000 rupees to 11 crore farmers of India, an amount worth 1 lakh 11 thousand crore plus every year, all by direct benefit transfer. Take the case of GSTN, riding on technology made in India. Aadhaar, riding on technology made in India. Take the case of Ayushman Bharat, crores of Indians are getting 5 lakh for their operations of medical care every year, poor people, again through digital technology. From Aadhaar to GSTN to your Ayushman Bharat, digital payment. India has become the biggest center of the world in terms of digital payment. UPI, again, made in India. Therefore, how in few years India's digital ecosystem, from digital payment to direct benefit transfer to low-cost technology like Aadhaar, like GSTN, like Ayushman Bharat, like UPI, made by young Indian scientists and entrepreneurs, is showing results. I want to say, do you know that we sent gas subsidy to 8 crore our sisters and mothers during Corona, all by direct benefit transfer. Then contact tracing, concentrated SMS in the areas of quarantine, Arogya Setu, contact tracing made by Indian entrepreneurs, used by about 16 crore Indians. If you come in contact with someone afflicted, then you can be immediately identified, isolate yourself. The system will respond to you. This vaccine program, again being digitally monitored through Covaxin. I'm giving you just examples. You know, today there are, we set up a e-marketplace, ENAM, National Agriculture Market, for farmers to sell their produce digitally. Today 1,000 mandis of India are linked, and close to 1.5 crore farmers are doing their business, and they have done business worth 1 lakh crore. Therefore, this is what we could do during COVID, the most challenging times, apart from upgrading India's digital infrastructure. We are going to link 6 lakh villages of India by optical fiber network, BharatNet. It has already begun. The PM announced from Red Fort last year, 1,000 days we will do it, and we are doing it. We want each village to become self-sufficient with digital footprint. These are transformative programs, you must understand that. And digital skilling, digital education. For me, the happiest moment is when I move in the villages of India and I find young boys telling me, sir, we are also doing Googling now. We are also using search engine through our smartphone. I see a different, empowered India talking to me. Therefore, the first question I would like to address you as IAS aspirant to understand the extraordinary power and delivery potential of the digital platform. So that in the event you sit on the chair, you must have this in mind that you are going to use it to reach the most marginalized people of the country and the area you serve. I was very clear from the very beginning that Digital India to succeed must become a mass movement. And then I employed a platform, Common Service Center, CSC. And I would like all the aspirants to appreciate this platform for your own future projections of development. When I became minister in 2014, that number was hardly 80,000. Now I have scaled up to nearly 4 lakh in all the village panchayats they are there. What is CSC? It is a digital kiosk for delivery of services. They make passport. They make digital payments, they give land records, they do skilling. They are the nodal point for Pradhan Mantri Gramin Vikas Yojana, Pradhan Mantri Gramin Awas Yojana, in many cases registering the people for this Ayushman Bharat. Many of them have become the volunteers of Economic Survey of India for payment of electricity bill and a host of other activities. Many of them have working in a manner, they have also started doing a lot of homegrown activity, including some of them have started doing coaching centers through their computer network in far-flung areas of the country. Entrepreneurship is growing. 12 lakh boys and girls work there, 60,000 women entrepreneurs. And this COVID, I asked them to become a little entrepreneurs and open e-Gramin stores. Many of them opened. I will be happy to know that it did a business of 150 crores. Now big banks, big companies are approaching them to become their front-end delivery agents. As a law minister, I have used them for telelaw. What is telelaw? Pre-litigation advice to a distressed daughter-in-law in a village, or to a poor liberal not getting legal advice on non-payment of his dues. It's a panel of lawyers who guides them as to what legal roadmap they need to take. 2.5 lakh advices we have been able to give in the last couple of years. In this 26th of January, the plaque of my department, MeeTee, had two ladies who are actually running CSC centers. I said, no models, let my actual workers be there. A lot of them got involved of delivery of crops or fruits with proper application of an app developed by entrepreneurs. The great lychee of Bihar was sent to London. A lot of vegetable growers are getting good payment from different digital markets. These are some of the positive, constructive experiences which I conveyed to you. And therefore, the digital ecosystem of India has got a momentum of its own. For me, the happiest moment comes when I go to a district and the collector shows me this is the app I have developed to interact with my people whom I serve, where there is a proper dashboard in his mobile phone as to which village has got what service, how much delivery. This is called digital monitoring. We have got a very famous other platform where all the state governments of India and state government services are available at a click of a button. These are some of the general examples which I thought I must share with you. But what is important for you is to understand the fundamental potential of these platforms for effective delivery of services. That is very important. Therefore, some of the general view I gave to you, we are also promoting electronic manufacturing in a big way. You know, India is becoming a big center of electronic manufacturing. When we had come to power, there were only 2 mobile factories in India. Now there are 260 plus factories in India. We have become the second most powerful nation manufacturing mobiles in India. We introduced a new scheme, PLI, Production Link Incentive. What is Production Link Incentive? Set up your shop, start manufacturing, produce mobile and components, export outside, also take care of domestic market, create jobs and get the incentive. That is Production Link Incentive. Today, all the top giants of the world, you name them, in the mobile field, have set up shop in India. Many have migrated from other countries also to India. India is a safe country, open society, democratic country. Therefore, I foresee a very extraordinary potential for India to become a global player in the global supply chain and also manufacturing of electronic products, be it telecom, be it mobile, be it laptop, be it desktop, be it IoT devices, be it others, iPad, etc. We are also addressing the concerns of data economy. The data protection law is already being finalized by the Select Committee of Parliament. We are very clear about a few things. India feels very strongly about the data sovereignty of India. The data of any Indian should not be taken without his consent, taken voluntarily. And other provisions are there. But having said that, I do acknowledge the need for data movement also. Data economy is going to be an important component of economy. And I want India to become a big center of data economy, data cleaning, data innovation, data value addition. That is a big area of growth. I'm very happy startup movement in India is also picking up very fast. This movement started in 2015. Today India has become the third biggest startup movement in the world. A lot of young people making products. Atmanirbhar Bharat, lots of Indian tech designers are creating problems. If there was a problem with Twitter, we had the coup made by Indian entrepreneurs. And I see a lot of other platforms coming in. And we are very happy about it that NASSCOM report suggests last year when there was COVID in India, 1,34,000 jobs were created in the IT sector in India. See the potential. And that's how I see the exciting time for India. There was growth in the IT sector also. Therefore, my young friends, very briefly, I thought I must explain to you the digital ecosystem of India. Yes, we are committed to the right of privacy, that is the law of the land, besides the Supreme Court of India. And my view about digital platform is, it has to be safe and secure. We very much appreciate the social media platform empowering ordinary Indians. They ask questions and we need to answer, why not? But these platforms, which are the finest creations of human mind, including internet, must not be abused by the terrorists, by those who want to wreak violence in the country. And if internet is a global phenomena, it must have linkage with the local ideas, local culture. Because internet is a great cementing force for the world. And now let me tell you very clearly, internet may have been founded by few, but today the entire humanity must own internet. That's how I see it. So these were some of my general views, friends, which I thought I must share with you. Good luck to you. And surely, what you learn in this interaction would add value to your preparation to succeed in the competitive examination. Thank you. Jai Hind.